Choices not because it's what the books say, choices not because it's what the popular opinion says, choice is not because of what the latest research says, but choice is because you are in tune with the divine creator who made you, and who knew exactly what was necessary for you in order to find true fulfillment. What I'm submitting to you is that nobody knows best how your life ought to be orchestrated than he who created it, which is God. And so if it is true, the Bible claims that God is the one that created us, if it is true that the Bible claims that God is the one who made the entire universe, then it is also true that the best way to find out how to live life is to go back to one that made it all. And so you will find, as you begin to go throughout your academic careers, you will find particularly young people as you begin to go to college, etc., those with the old will find you continue to meet people, that you will meet perhaps some of the most ingenious people, and one thing will stand out to you, that is that they may find it particularly strange that you still persist in the belief and the acknowledgement of God. You'll find it particularly strange that you still believe in something called, dare I say, religion. They will find it strange that you still hold on to what to them has likely become a fable. They'll think it strange that you believe in the historical Jesus, not only attested by the historians that decree that once upon a time there was a man named Jesus, but that further you believe that he rose from the dead on the third day according to the scriptures. You'll find that also strange. You'll find yourself many times having to balance the integrity of what you know within yourself and your own experiences with God, which hopefully are accumulating over the years as you come and serve, as you experience your own lives, you begin to know for sure today God exists, not merely because we tell you, but because you see his fingerprint in your life on a daily basis. When you have to balance that and wrestle with that against the convincing, in many cases very convincing words of people that they perhaps seem much smarter and more intelligent than you or any others you've ever encountered, who will tell you that everything that you ever believe has been at worst, or on one hand, a lie, and worse, a scream, and a fable. And so you have to balance that and say, God, how do I maintain my belief? You don't want to help me with that. But today, recognizing that it's a foolish thing to abnegate or to say that God does not exist. Now, I could argue this from a number of perspectives. We can talk about the divine design argument that says that in order for us to have the beautiful things that we see in creation, that there must have been an intelligent designer behind it all. I could talk about all of that. I could talk to you about the fact that evolution, or regardless of evolution, requires just as much faith, if not more, than to believe or to espouse creationism. I could share with you from a philosophical standpoint that if life only consists in this, and if there is no big picture, how utterly futile and meaningless life becomes. That if the injustices of the injustice that exists in this world, and the number of terrible calamities that befall humankind at the hands of other humans goes unpunished both in this world and in the next, how utterly unfair life would seem if there were no God. We could talk about all of that, but in a very practical sense, I want to share with you that the Bible simply declares without much more clarification than this, that it is simply utterly foolish not to believe in God. And you might say, well, what am I supposed to do? What is God calling me to? What does God want from me? And worst of all, you see the text, it says they are corrupt, they've done abominable works, there's none that doeth good. Good. What is it about believing God or recognition of the fact that there is a God that translates our works of darkness into works of good? That translates our works of abomination or abominable works into works that give God pleasure? But the motive, but the understanding, but the big picture perspective, what's being articulated is the fact that if you're not doing all things towards the glory and the honor of God, at some point you end up with selfish motives. At some point you begin doing things in a way that is self-serving. And no matter how much good you do, if you do the good that you do with yourself in mind, with your self-investment in mind, with your self-aggrandizement in mind, even the good that you do becomes evil and becomes utterly corrupt. The only way that you're able to be set free from the corruption of this cycle is to actually do things with a mindset that elevates it above your satisfaction. And you begin to see things from the perspective of, I want to please God. And when you transition from pleasing self to pleasing God, that's when God starts to see things as being good. The foolishness is on this wise, that you actually believe that you can have a good life without Him that is the source of life. Unfortunately, for many people, they're not able to fully see the peril, fully see the folly of their ways, until at some point it seems like life has passed them by. I want to give you a short story, and I think I'm going to conclude. But there I was. I was in class. In fact, teacher, I was in ninth grade, the grade to which you were going. And it was my first in-depth introduction to the theory of evolution. And I am not speaking this to be anti-evolution, but I am speaking this to be anti-anything that does not include God at the center and origin and source of creation. And there I was in this class with a young lady who also had claimed to be a believer. She was going to church regularly, participating in Christian-type endeavors. We're sitting there, and we had been introduced to carbon dating. We had been introduced to a number of scientific quotable facts with respect to the evolution of species. And having become acquainted with phylum and kingdom and all these sort of things, and the similarities that exist between the species, what was proposed to us was that over a series of years as a result of a cataclysmic Big Bang, everything that we see, including life, came into existence. At that point, she leans over to me and says, what do you think about that, Blake? And I begin to share with her, I believe in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. She leans over to me and she says, William, I don't see how you can be so smart and be so stupid. How can you have all this evidence presented to you and you not believe in evolution? I didn't return the insult, nor did I try to convince her otherwise. But something funny began to happen, that as years began to go by, I began to watch a lot of the scientific information that was coming out. I began to see that much of what was presented as fact was still, at the end of the day, a theory, and that many of these theories were being disproven on a daily basis. For example, we still have not shown in one single instance the evolution of one species to another. I appreciate the contribution of Charles Darwin. Many of you know I began as a biology major in college, so I'm quite well acquainted. And I actually did microbiological research at the university. And so I'm quite well acquainted with Darwin's theory of evolution, and more specifically, his theory of natural selection and origin of species. And I do believe that if you have certain species that have certain characteristics, that if you are selective in how you interbreed them, that certain of those characteristics will become more prominent or become more pervasive. I agree with that. And I think that every dog breeder agrees with that. But what I have not seen is someone successfully able to take, for example, a dog and breed a dog and breed a dog and somehow end up with, and I'm not applying this to direction, but for the purpose of simplicity, and end up with a cat. That somehow the line between species seems to be sharply divided. That you can't even take two species of different animals, put them together, and get an offspring to come out of it. And so at the end of the day, you look back and you hear the accusation that I'm crazy for believing in God, that I'm foolish for believing in God, that it's a knock against my intelligence to believe in God. what I might even call a degree of common sense, along with the research that's coming out now. And I wonder who's really the fool. I look at people that have decided they want to build a society outside of God, that we no longer need God to serve the basis for our moral actions, that somehow, without the premise of God, without the pervasiveness of God, the intrusion of God, some would dare say, into our society, we can have a fulfilling existence. And then I'm looking at what sociological reports are telling us, that as we get further and further away from God, apparently, we're not getting all the benefits that were promised to us, despite all the great claims that were made by such great intellectuals. And then I begin to wonder who's really the fool. We've begun to move away from how God instructs us in terms of parents and children, including the structure of the families, including the rearing of children, and proper discipline, etc. And we've listened to the voices of countless social scientists who have spoken to us and given us all types of information and research and studies, and have told us that despite what we have heard from the Word of God, despite what God has given us in terms of the proper order and structure of His own creation, that there is somehow a better way to do it that does not include Him. And then we look back over history and we look and we examine, we've got to ask the question, who's really the fool? We look at the infrastructure of our families, to go back to that, and restate it again. We talk about the importance of both fathers and mothers and raising and rearing the children, the proper order of families. And we've watched the decimation of it in many cases, particularly in our urban communities, not saying because I'm not afraid to, but just in our urban communities, the decimation of the nuclear family structure that we've had so many. And I want to use the word empowered. Liberated, I guess is the terminology. Liberated young women in many cases who decided that despite God's warning and God's prescription with respect to marriage prior to building a family, that quite frankly, I've heard them say they don't need a man. And so go about the task of structuring single households, and certainly there are exceptional cases where perhaps a spouse dies and a woman is left widow. Certainly understand that, but we're talking about not these exceptional cases. We're talking about when people make conscious decisions to go against the order of God, to do something that is utterly wrong. In the process of doing so, people feeling liberated, I'm free, I can do what I want. Then you look at our communities and you look where we have quote unquote done what we've wanted to. And we look at the erosion of both respect for authority and the erosion of even of familial cohesiveness. And then you've got to ask the question, who's really operating in foolishness? Because the truth of the matter is that it's not about how much you can study, it's not about how much you can accumulate in terms of worldly facts and knowledge. At the end of the day, the question really becomes, are you able to live life in a way that produces sustainable and long-term results? And unfortunately, too many times when we go about the task of doing life our own way, we find out only after it's too late how short-sighted we were in our perspective. And I submit to you that we talk about the wisdom of God is not only about being to see things from God's perspective, but included within that is the ability to see things from the perspective of the long term. That many of the wisdom keys that are entrusted to us in the book of Proverbs are about being able to see beyond what's standing in front of you and staring you in the face, and rather to be able to see through that and beyond that, and to recognize that the action that I've made today, although it may temporarily satisfy me, in the long term, it can be detrimental. And so for children, it teaches them the importance of hearing the voice of your father, even though in the short term, it instructs doubts of the mother, as it's spoken of in the book of Proverbs, then you'll find that over the long term, the wisdom that has been picked up by your parents can help you save years, perhaps even decades off of your own lives, because you've listened to their principles. Probably one of the greatest obstacles to wisdom, and this is all on my mind today, and I'm mindful of supposed to be concluded. One of the greatest, perhaps, obstacles to wisdom is perhaps intelligence. And so I advise that we become smarter and smarter, even in the church. And as we become smarter, we say, oh, older saint, oh, older pastor, oh, older preacher. I hear what you're saying, but I went to school, or I hear what you're saying, and I know the Greek, or I hear what you're saying, but I have information and data. And unfortunately, we get to push away those that have experience of life, those that have lived longer, those that know the way. And because we think we have 2 ounces of intelligence, perhaps more than they do, we push them aside, we elevate ourselves, and we think that our intellect will be able to help us. And for a little bit of time, we impress one another with our vocabulary, impress one another with our complex theories, impress one another with this, that, and the other. And ultimately, what you begin to find out is that, hey, life is not the complicated machine that you have made it. And that the wisdom of the elders that have come before you is not ignorance, but that in many cases, they actually knew what they were talking about, even if they could not articulate it with words like you. Even if they could not speak with the same degree of precision that you could, they knew something that many of you did not. And I want to submit to you tonight, this afternoon, that the wisdom of God, the knowledge of God, and I know we now live in a society that is moving away from the knowledge of God, the appreciation of God. But what I'm telling you is that our forefathers, those that went on before us that were religious persuasion, were not insane. They were not crazy. They were not backwards in their understanding. But they knew that the existence of God could not be compromised. They understood that God, as Lady Blagmon sung so eloquently this morning, yes, God